For our ancient ancestors, recognizing patterns was essential for survival. As they entered the world, they observed landscape patterns, observed weather patterns, and behavioral patterns in birds and animals. When they looked up at the night sky, they also observed patterns. They discovered that the stars needed to be evenly distributed across the sky. Numerous brightest stars are arranged in a manner that naturally attracts the eye. As the Earth rotates, these stars appear to move in tandem, providing additional evidence that they are related. Connect the dots with these star clusters through play. The ancients transformed them into images, frequently of mythical creatures. Occasionally, stars that appear close together in the sky are related. They are known as constellations. Constellations continue to exist, reminding us of our ancestors' interest in the stars. However, these ancient star images may contain more than meets the eye. One of the most recognizable star patterns, the Big Dipper, reflects the arrangement of these seven stars. They resemble the outline of a pot with a handle when combined. There are alternative perspectives, however. In some folk traditions, the wagon or the plow replaces the Dipper, and for the ancient Greeks and Romans, the central animal was Ursa, the Great Bear. The official name astronomers still use for this constellation is Capricorn. Turning these stars into the image of a bear is a stretch. The bear is usually portrayed with the handle of the Big Dipper as its long tail, even though real bears don't have long tails. But the bear connection makes more sense when we consider that the ancient Greeks called this constellation Arctos, which gives us the word Arctic. So Arctos or Ursa Major may be our link to a much older tradition of bear legends that stretches back to the end of the last ice age, when the inhabitants of Europe and Asia were nomads wandering in a great northern wilderness. Perhaps they were the ones who first connected the most potent animal in their world to the most prominent star pattern in their sky. So it seems fitting that in more recent times, astronomers have learned that the stars of the Big Dipper are themselves a roving band of stellar nomads. This became clear in 1869 when British astronomer Richard Proctor noticed five of the seven main stars. Proctor discovered what is now known as the Ursa significant relationship. The Dippers are all moving through space at the same speed and direction. Instead, star clusters tend to disperse as they move through the galaxy. This means that the Ursa Major group may be much larger than it appears. Throughout history, when adventurers and traders headed east or west to distant lands, they knew they were bringing their constellations. As the Earth turns, places on the globe at similar latitudes like Europe, Asia, and North America will see the same stars. But those who travel south experience something very different. The Earth does not rotate from north to south, so some stars and constellations can never be seen from northern latitudes. For example, it's here in the south that we find Centaurus. It's a sprawling constellation depicted by the ancient Greeks as a spear-wielding centaur, an imaginary creature half man and half horse, similar to Ursa Major, the Great Bear. The outline of the centaur may seem obscure to modern eyes, but there's no mistaking the two brightest stars in this constellation, Alpha and Beta Centauri. Together, they point to another group of four stars, which the ancients also imagined as part of the centaur. Today, we identify this group as a separate constellation, one of the most famous, the Southern Cross. The combination of the Southern Cross with Alpha and Beta Centauri forms the dominant star pattern of the Southern Hemisphere, whether it's one constellation or two. But how did the ancient Greek astronomers know about these stars, which can't be seen from Greece? The answer is precession, because of precession. Precession is a term that describes a gradual change in the direction of Earth's axis, as our planet slowly swivels around in space like a giant gyroscope. For instance, the stars of Centaurus and the Southern Cross have shifted over the centuries. Once upon a time, they were visible from Europe. Now they're visible from the south, a tiny fraction of the age of the sun. Blue stars eventually expand as they run out of fuel and transform into red supergiants. This happened to the brightest group member, the brilliant red star Antares. This has already occurred in the Scorpius-Centaurus association. According to astronomers, One or more of the association's stars may have exploded as a supernova within the last 15 million years, causing the bubble to form. Our solar system lies outside Loop 1 in a smaller bubble, which may have also been caused by a supernova. So far, this idea remains speculative, and there are reasons to be skeptical. Astronomers have calculated that a supernova would have to be within 26 light years of Earth to cause such severe damage to our planet. While that's not impossible, a supernova going off so close to us recently would be quite a coincidence. What we do know is that our planet did change at that time. Winter in the northern hemisphere is when many brightest stars can be seen high overhead. Among them are Castor and Pollux. These two stars, almost identical in brightness, are the Gemini twins. They're part of a constellation that depicts two brothers in the heavens, but these stars are not related at just 34 light years from Earth. Pollux is closer and older than Castor at 50 light years away. They are siblings in name only. It's the same story with another well-known winter constellation, Cassiopeia, named after a mythical queen. The five brightest stars in Cassiopeia form a W pattern that's easy to spot in the northern sky. But in this case, the grouping is pure coincidence. The stars in the W are spread out along a line of sight that ranges from about 50 to over 500 light years away. They too are not related. Nevertheless, most stars must have relatives somewhere because they tend to form clusters within vast dust and gas clouds. Looking at the Southern Cross stars, we can see a recent example near the cross. However, 6,000 light years away lies one of the southern sky's greatest treasures, in the 19th century. Astronomer John Herschel called this the Jewel Box Star Cluster. With its concentration of hot blue stars and bright red giants, the cluster reminded Herschel of a casket full of precious stones. Today, astronomers estimate the cluster contains about 100 stars formed around 12 million years ago. As the cluster ages, the brightest stars will quickly exhaust their fuel and burn out. In some cases, they will go supernova like the stars of the Scorpius-Centaurus Association. Those remaining stars will continue to travel together like the Ursa Major group. But over billions of years, they're destined to drift apart and lose each other among the stars of the Milky Way. Our own Sun is one such star. It is now 4.5 billion years old. It too must have relatives somewhere out there in the galaxy. Some of those sibling stars could have planets and even life. Since life here is based on the chemical ingredients that went into forming the Sun, it would be fascinating to see what happened to the same ingredients elsewhere. But could we find the Sun's long-lost relatives? Are they hidden somewhere among the familiar constellations? One approach to answering these questions is to look at the nearest stars and see if any have strong similarities to our Sun. The nearest star is Alpha Centauri, although it appears as a single light point to the eye. Alpha Centauri is a multiple star system composed of three stars orbiting each other. The smallest is a red dwarf star known as Proxima Centauri because it's the closest of the three. The entire system is only 4.3 light years from us. That's still thousands of times farther than the most distant planet in our solar system. But for a star, it's very, very close. In fact, it's so close that Alpha Centauri can't be a member of the Scorpius-Centaurus Association. Nevertheless, it is in the foreground when we look towards those stars. Similarly, someone living on a planet in the Alpha Centauri system would see our Sun as part of the constellation Cassiopeia, giving the W an extra zigzag. But even if such a planet exists, we already know that any creatures living there cannot be our galactic cousins. The Alpha Centauri system is older than the Sun and moving on its own separate course. After its closest approach, about 27,000 years from now, the system will gradually start to pull away from us, eventually fading into the starry background. Meanwhile, the search for our Sun's actual siblings continues. In 2013, astronomers studied 30 stars with ages, compositions, and motions similar to the Sun. After a close examination, only one of the 30 qualified as a possible sibling to the Sun. It lies just over 100 light years away in the constellation Hercules. It doesn't have a name, it's just a catalogue. HD 162826 is the number. But this one candidate sibling could soon be joined by others. In December 2013, Europe launched the Gaia mission. It's a space telescope that will help construct a 3D catalogue of nearly a billion stars. As never before, roughly 1% of the Milky Way's total stellar population now lives there. Gaia will reveal precisely where all the stars are around us and show us how they move. Doing so will reveal which stars are genuinely associated with one another, including those that might have a connection to our Sun. Long ago, our ancestors looked for patterns in the stars and invented constellations, groups, and stars with stories to tell. Now, Gaia gives us a more sophisticated way of observing the stars. But we're still looking for patterns. What we find will reveal the unseen relationships among the stars around us and give us a new set of stories. It may even give us a story that includes us. The story of a great family of stars that formed together in a cloud spread out into the galaxy, bringing the galaxy to life along the way. Not so long ago, astronomers thought they were getting close to understanding what the universe was made of. First, matter makes up the stars and galaxies that light up our night sky. Then there's dark matter. It's thought to be an unknown type of particle that gives off no light. But we know it exists because of its gravitational pull. Astronomers have recently discovered a third presence in our universe that is not matter. Instead, it's a mysterious phenomenon that could be caused by empty space. It's called dark energy, and its growing influence in the universe is so essential that it will dictate the ultimate fate of everything else. The only trouble is that cosmologists need to figure out what dark energy is, and finding out has become one of the greatest scientific quests of our time. The seeds of the quest were planted nearly a century ago. That's when astronomers first became aware that the tiny blobs and swirls of light they could see in their telescopes were galaxies. Galaxies are vast systems of stars, like our own Milky Way, but far off in the cosmic distance. Here. The Hubble Space. Telescope peers across the edge of the Milky Way towards the constellation Centaurus to reveal Spiral Galaxy 83. Compared to other galaxies, M83 is a close neighbor to the Milky Way, just 15 million light-years away, but this system rapidly moves away from us at over 500 kilometers per second. Many more galaxies are doing the same thing much farther in space. Here. The Hubble telescope explores a giant elliptical galaxy surrounded by a swarm of smaller neighbors. This galaxy cluster is more than 30 times farther away than Man 3 and receding at more than 10,000 kilometers per second. No matter where we look in the universe, astronomers have found that the farther a galaxy is from us, the faster it's moving away. In the 1920s, astronomer Edwin Hubble first grasped the meaning of this relationship. Hubble realized that all the galaxies must be spreading apart, making more distant galaxies appear to recede more quickly. The discovery resulted in an astounding conclusion. Our universe is expanding in all directions and is not static, and as space expands, galaxies expand along with it. An expanding universe is a strange concept, but it makes sense. Gravity would have already brought together all galaxies if the universe were static. The expansion clarifies why this has yet to occur. However, it also leads to another significant conclusion. Since space is expanding, it must have been less expansive in the past. The visible universe was contained within a space smaller than an atom at one point. Unimaginable to have so much matter and energy in such a small area. However, this circumstance was the cause of the Big Bang. The blazing beginning of the universe. After discovering the Big Bang, astronomers realized they could determine when it occurred by measuring the rate at which galaxies flew apart and then the expansion in reverse. Astronomers must initially compare the distance and velocity between galaxies. Speed is relatively simple. When objects are in motion, their frequency shifts are proportional to their speed. The term for this is the Doppler effect. On Earth, measuring the distance to a galaxy is much more difficult. It measures the speed of approaching storms and serves as the basis for police radar. And for most of the 20th century, even the largest telescopes could not do so with precision. When the Hubble Space Telescope was launched, this would change. Liftoff, providing astronomers with a new and improved perspective of galaxies. Hubble could peer into nearby galaxies and, for the first time, observe individual stars within these galaxies. However, astronomers were searching for more than just stars. Consequently, in 1993, astronomers utilized the Hubble to search for Cepheid variables concealed within nearby galaxies. The more brilliantly they shine, the more slowly they pulse. By timing a Cepheid's pulsation, astronomers can determine the amount of light it emits and its distance. Cepheids allowed them to determine the distance to each galaxy. Then, using the Doppler shift, astronomers could determine how quickly these galaxies are receding from us as the universe expands. The final step is merely mathematical. The universe's expansion rate for each galaxy is the speed divided by the distance. The greater the number of galaxies measured, the more reliable the result, and by knowing the rate at which the universe is expanding, astronomers can determine when everything began. It was one of Hubble's most significant discoveries. However, astronomers were perplexed when the answer began to emerge in 1994. According to their calculations, the universe is less than 12 billion years old. This was older than previous estimates and contradicted other evidence. The evidence included white dwarf stars and tiny stellar relics that are no more significant than the Earth and are left behind when stars like our Sun die. Inside globular clusters, one can find some of the oldest white dwarf stars. The formation of these vast spherical swarms of stars predates the formation of our galaxy, because white dwarf stars gradually cool over time. Astronomers can use the most remarkable and dimmest white dwarfs in a cluster to determine their age. The problem is that the oldest white dwarfs appear older than 12 billion years. Thus, they would be older than the universe. Astronomers needed a crucial piece of information somehow, somewhere. In 1998, the missing piece was discovered and everything was altered. It involved a different method for determining the distances between galaxies. This technique is based on a specific type of exploding star observed from a significantly greater distance than Cepheid variables. Two stars that orbit each other are involved in the explosion. The first is a tiny white dwarf, while the second is a massive red giant. In this scenario, gravity pulls escaping hot gas from the giant star onto its companion white dwarf. Eventually, sufficient matter falls onto the white dwarf to render it unstable. This results in a thermonuclear explosion, which causes the white dwarf to become a supernova. Crucial for astronomers is that the explosion's trigger point is always the same. Thus, supernovae of this type always exhibit approximately the same maximum luminosity. As with Cepheid variables, knowing the actual luminosity of something entails understanding its distance. However, supernovae can be observed in even more distant galaxies, and their light reaches us from a more remote period. They anticipated that the expansion would gradually slow down. This is because the gravity of all matter and dark matter in the universe is a brake on cosmic expansion. When there is more matter, there is more gravity. When there is more gravity, it is more difficult for things to fly apart. However, they found the exact opposite: accelerating expansion of the universe. This unexpected discovery explains the discrepancy regarding the age of the universe. If space expands faster now than before, the universe must have taken longer to reach its current size. That would make the age of the universe greater than 12 billion years. It is estimated to be 13.8 billion years old, making it older than any known star. However, if the universe is accelerating, what is the cause? Like dark matter, there was no direct way to observe this new phenomenon. Therefore, cosmologists termed it dark energy. In 2011, three astronomers were involved in the initial discovery, confirmed and strengthened by subsequent observations. The Nobel Prize has been awarded to Saul Perlmutter, Brian Schmidt, and Adam Riese. The discovery of dark energy added intrigue and mystery to the universe. Now it was up to cosmologists to comprehend the implications of an accelerating universe in their theories. In 2001, cosmologists were given a new perspective on the role of dark energy in the universe. A spacecraft in orbit aimed to map the cosmic microwave background. A background is a remnant of light emitted shortly after the Big Bang when the universe was still extremely hot. This signal is no longer visible to the naked eye due to the Doppler shift, but can be detected in the microwave portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. The data reveal that the sum is significantly greater than all galaxies. In reality, all the visible matter constitutes only 5% of the cosmos. The galaxies, however, are embedded within vast concentrations of dark matter that add up to a much greater total. Dark matter contributes another 27% to the total amount of ingredients. This leaves unaccounted for more than two-thirds of the universe's contents. This missing portion, cosmologists now believe, is absorbed by dark energy, the mysterious force accelerating the universe's expansion. To comprehend what this implies for the universe, however, we must understand what dark energy is. One potential answer has existed for roughly a century. This is known as the cosmological constant. Albert Einstein added this mathematical term to his theory of general relativity to counteract gravity. Einstein used it to explain why the universe's matter had not converged into a single point. Einstein realized he no longer needed the cosmological constant once astronomers discovered the universe expanded. So far, the observations support this theory, but there are other hypotheses. For instance, dark energy results from a previously unknown natural force. If so, its influence may diminish gradually over time. For instance, the universe's acceleration could be accelerated. In this case, it will eventually surpass all other forces, separating galaxies, stars, and atoms. Cosmologists refer to this as the Great Rip. A group of scientists from the United States has launched the Dark Energy Survey to distinguish between these possibilities. This project employs a Chilean telescope equipped with a specialized camera that can search for evidence of dark energy in multiple ways. Examining the large-scale structure of the universe is one method. This structure resembles a cosmic spider web, with galaxies clustered in enormous strands that separate millions of light-year-wide voids. The regular spacing of these strands can be used as a giant ruler to determine how the expansion of space has changed over time if measured precisely. The Dark Energy Survey began in late 2013 to better understand dark energy. Scientists hope to measure as many as 300 million galaxies in 5 years. In the meantime, Canadian astronomers have discovered that they can perform the same function with radio waves as the dark energy camera does with light. Their project involves a series of 100-meter-long radio antennas shaped like troughs. As the Earth rotates, the troughs map the distribution of intergalactic hydrogen clouds that pass overhead. Hydrogen clouds are easier to detect than individual galaxies, so astronomers can use them to peer back to earlier times in cosmic history when it may have been simpler to differentiate between competing theories of dark energy. In addition, the European Space Agency has proposed a space telescope named Euclid, specifically designed to measure dark energy. It may debut as early as 2020. And NASA is currently planning the W1 Dark Energy Telescope launch in 2024. Before 20 years ago, nobody knew about dark energy. Now its comprehension is our cosmic priority. And there is something quite fitting about that. By that time, space will have expanded so rapidly that light from the cosmic background and most galaxies will be unable to cross it. These galaxies vanish beyond the cosmic horizon. They will bring with them evidence of dark energy. This is the greatest discovery ever. Previously, astronomers believed there was little left to learn about the universe. This agreement is available for a limited time only. On a typical morning, dawn breaks and the sun climbs into the eastern sky as the day begins. However, as it illuminates the world, nobody knows that a strange transformation will commence. Gradually, a slight depression develops in the vast spherical disk of the sun. It grows minute by minute until, after an hour, more than half of the sun has vanished. The day has become noticeably darker and shadows are becoming more distinct. As the sun becomes a thin crescent, birds become agitated and confused because it appears that night is approaching too quickly. Then darkness descends. And above, in place of the sun, is a strange, almost magical spectacle. It appears as though a perfectly round black hole has been punched into the surrounding sky. There is a white, ghostly aura. A total solar eclipse mesmerizes the world with its ethereal beauty. We can only speculate. How do you believe our prehistoric ancestors would have reacted to this extraordinary natural occurrence, particularly if it had occurred unexpectedly? A total solar eclipse may have appeared to be the world's end, or it could be a sign from God. As impressive as an eclipse can be, it is even more impressive that ancient people could comprehend and predict their causes. Realizing that eclipses involve both the sun and the moon is crucial. A solar eclipse occurs when the moon passes in front of the sun, casting its shadow on Earth's surface, and a lunar eclipse occurs when the moon moves to the opposite side of its orbit, passing through the Earth's shadow. However, precisely predicting when an eclipse will occur is more difficult. Even though the moon orbits the Earth once per month, eclipses are much less frequent. This is because a slight tilt in the moon's orbit causes the shadows cast by the moon and Earth to not align perfectly most of the time. In any given year, only 4 or 5 eclipses are possible, with lunar and solar eclipses occurring in pairs. Some of these eclipses are partial, meaning that only a portion of the sun or moon is obscured. Such eclipses can easily be noticed, if not anticipated. Other eclipses occur when the sky is cloudy or in remote regions of the globe, such as the high Arctic or Antarctica, where few people are observing. When these factors are considered, very few individuals will witness more than a handful of eclipses. Most of these will be lunar eclipses, because a lunar eclipse can be observed anywhere the moon is visible, roughly half the Earth at any given time. This indicates that our prehistoric ancestors were almost certainly aware of the possibility of eclipses. When ancient sky watchers meticulously recorded eclipses over generations, a longer-term eclipse pattern emerged. This pattern is known as the Saros cycle, and it was discovered by astronomers in Mesopotamia. Unfortunately, solar eclipses in the same 18-year series occurred in different parts of the world, making it more difficult for ancient people to detect this. For example, here is a spectacular image of a total solar eclipse observed in July 1991 in Mexico. The next eclipse in this series occurred 18 years later, on schedule, in July 2009. However, it was spotted in China. 3 zeros, or approximately 54 years, passed before a similar solar eclipse occurs in roughly the same region of the world. According to historical records, the Greek astronomer Thales predicted a solar eclipse successfully around 585 BC. Such ancient documents serve a scientific purpose today. Astronomers can compare where eclipses were observed in the past to where calculations indicate they should have been. The differences indicate that the Earth's rotation has changed slightly over thousands of years. Today, scientists can precisely predict where and when eclipses will occur. But they have become more alluring. Thus, the mystery surrounding eclipses has been replaced by anticipation and, for many, a strong desire to witness one of nature's most breathtaking sights. Even though the timing of an eclipse can be predicted to the second, eclipse observers are aware that the outcome of total lunar eclipses can still be unexpected. The lunar eclipse precedes the moon and first slides into Earth's outer shadow, known as the penumbra, where only a small portion of the sun's light is blocked from reaching the moon. This stage of the eclipse is barely discernible. Eventually, the moon might enter the inner shadow. The shadow. A partial lunar eclipse commences at this point, with a portion of the moon's becoming visibly dark. However, even if the lunar eclipse is total and the moon enters the umbra, the moon will not vanish. A portion of the sun's light is refracted or bent as it passes through. The light is reddish because red sunlight can pass through the atmosphere most easily, as at sunset. However, how bright and red the eclipsed moon appears strongly depends on how much sunlight makes it through. The moon has a coppery hue when Earth's upper atmosphere is clear, when clarification is required. The resulting lunar eclipse is dark, crimson, or even brownish. After the 1991 eruption of Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines, this was proven to have a significant impact. It was the largest volcanic eruption in over a century, and approximately 20 tons of sulfur dioxide were released into the atmosphere. This resulted in a global layer of haze that persisted for months. And during a total lunar eclipse in December 1992, the moon was nearly invisible. Solar eclipses also vary in appearance, but the reasons have more to do with observer location, and it usually requires planning to be in the right place at the right time. During a solar eclipse, the moon's shadow sweeps across the surface of the Earth. Any location where the shadow falls will experience at least a partial solar eclipse. To view a total solar eclipse, however, you must be standing near the center of the moon's shadow in a zone that, depending on latitude, is typically less than 100 kilometers wide. On either side of this central portion of the shadow is a long, narrow path known as the path of totality. The eclipse of the sun is only partial. Within it, spectators are treated to a total solar eclipse. It is well worth the effort to reach the path of totality, as this is the only location where the most dramatic effects of a solar eclipse can be observed. And the difference between a partial and a total solar eclipse is literally the difference between night and day, even if only partially visible. The sun's blazing surface, the photosphere, easily outshines everything else in the sky. However, once the moon completely covers the photosphere, the sun's tenuous outer atmosphere becomes visible. Herein lies the corona. It consists of ionized particles blasted from the photosphere and heated to temperatures exceeding 1 million degrees. The feather-like structure of the corona is formed by a strong magnetic field generated within the sun and stretches far into space. The appearance of sunspots and darker, cooler regions on the sun's surface are related to the 11-year cycle of field variations. At the peak of the sunspot cycle, the corona tends to be round and symmetrical. When a few sunspots appear, the hair becomes long and spindly. This expanded corona version could have inspired the ancient Egyptian symbol of the sun with the wings. A total eclipse also provides a rare opportunity to observe plasma's long filaments and loops caught in the sun's magnetic field. These are known as solar prominences during a total eclipse. Prominent prominences frequently emit a ruby-red glow around the moon's dark periphery when the sun is completely obscured. Together, these features contribute to a fantastic temporary website due to the rapidity with which the moon's shadow traverses the Earth's surface. A total eclipse typically lasts up to a few minutes. Then, a sudden flare appears as the sun approaches the moon's waning edge in the final second. On the arid, icy plains of Mars, the sun is weak and pale, creating the illusion that the sky contains a diamond ring. For those observing, the diamond ring represents a parting gift from the solar eclipse and evidence that something truly extraordinary has occurred. Even though the sun is distant, solar eclipses are not. As seen from the planet's surface, two small moons orbit Mars and can cross in front of the sun. This has never been experienced by a human, but NASA's Curiosity rover has documented it. This is the view from Curiosity of a solar eclipse on Mars. Because moons are small and irregular, the sun is only partially obscured. The effects of a Martian solar eclipse could be more dramatic on Earth, despite their allure. Here, however, things are very different. Eclipses have a history of leaving profound marks wherever they occur. They have, in some instances, altered the course of history. For example, in March 1504, Christopher Columbus was beached in Jamaica when an astronomical table book informed him of an upcoming lunar eclipse. He utilized the eclipse to his advantage, impressing the local tribespeople with his apparent control of the event and convincing them to provide food for his crew. 2 centuries later, in response to a challenge from U.S. authorities, Ten Squad Talwar, a Shawnee spiritual leader, inspired his followers by predicting the June 1806 total solar eclipse. Under his brother's leadership, these followers would play a pivotal role in the War of 1812. Francis Bailey, A retired stockbroker with no formal astronomical training traveled to Scotland 30 years later to observe a solar eclipse. The eclipse was not total because the moon's orbital distance was greater than usual at the time. That meant it was too small to completely cover the sun. Consequently, Bailey witnessed what is now known as an annular eclipse, in which the exposed portion of the sun forms a ring or annulus around the moon. Bailey observed that the ring was so thin in some spots that the moon's mountain silhouettes were visible through it, converting the ring into a necklace of beads. Since then, this effect has been known as Bailey's beads. Bailey's description of the phenomenon was so captivating that the next eclipse in Europe in 1842 drew many astronomers. Eclipse in the decades that followed, science shifted into high gear. Several significant discoveries were made during solar eclipses. 1919 saw what may have been the most scientifically significant eclipse ever. Albert Einstein published his theory of general relativity, which united space and time and predicted that gravity bends light, only a few years earlier. The theory provided a novel perspective on the universe. The difficulty was determining how to test it. It was quickly realized that during a total solar eclipse it might be possible to observe the effect of the sun's gravity on the incoming light of background stars, which is normally impossible to observe when the sun is nearby. Therefore, British astronomer Arthur Eddington led an expedition to test Einstein in the spring of 1919. Observing from an island off of Africa's western coast. On the eclipse day, May 29th, Eddington awoke to overcast skies and heavy rain. The clouds then miraculously began to disperse 18 minutes before totality. Eddington made the decisive measurement by observing through clear patches. When Eddington presented his findings in England, he demonstrated that the background stars had shifted exactly as Einstein's theory predicted. Not all his colleagues were initially convinced, but the news caused a global sensation, and Einstein became a household name overnight. The effect of gravity on light has evolved into a potent tool in contemporary cosmology. It can transform vast clusters of galaxies into enormous natural lenses that magnify our view of the universe's more distant regions. However, it all began with a solar eclipse. After 100 years since the Eddington eclipse, eclipse chasing is no longer limited to scientists. It has become a sport. Each time a total solar eclipse occurs, there is an exciting region of the globe. There are numerous visitors, and the experience can be truly unique. And eventually this experience will cease to exist. Solar eclipses occur when the sun and the moon appear nearly the same size in the sky. The outcome was magical, but it was also a complete coincidence. According to ancient eclipse records, the Earth's rotation is gradually slowing. In response, the moon is progressively receding. Eventually, the moon will no longer appear large enough to completely obscure the sun. Astronomers predict that the final total solar eclipse in Earth's history will occur in approximately 600 million years. That still leaves us with numerous opportunities to witness one of the most magnificent sights in the universe. But why delay? Eclipses are natural phenomena that were designed specifically for human enjoyment. They serve as a reminder, which is true even on Earth. We inhabit a larger cosmos that appears to have an infinite capacity to enchant us. We have always been fascinated with the stars as a species. However, those who ponder the nature of the stars face a unique obstacle in the universe. How can we hope to comprehend that which we cannot touch? To determine the composition of the stars, we must do more than grasp them. Over the centuries, astronomers have discovered that the stars reveal their secrets when viewed properly. However, distance is a manageable barrier to comprehension. Initially, ancient thinkers compared the stars to their everyday experiences. Around 450 BC, the Greek philosopher Anaxagoras concluded that the stars must be like stones emitting intense heat but too distant for us to feel. In reality, there was some truth to this. A century later, when Aristotle observed the stars, he disagreed. Aristotle stated that because stars behave differently, they cannot be made of fire, stone, or anything we encounter on Earth. As they rise and set each night, The stars move in circles around us instead of moving in straight lines like falling objects. And the stars appear to never change. Aristotle believed they were eternal and composed of a divine substance known as the ether. The ideas of Aristotle would reign supreme for the next 18 centuries until astronomers began to see things differently. They realized the stars are not rotating in circles. Instead, we are spinning because we inhabit a planet that revolves and follows a curved path around the sun. In 1572, a brilliant new star appeared for a time in the constellation Cassiopeia. It was the brightest star in the sky. Then, after several months, it gradually disappeared from view. Today, we understand that this interstellar intruder was a supernova, the violent demise of a massive star. At a distance of over 8,000 light years, the remnants of that explosion are still visible as a vast bubble in space. However, what mattered to astronomers then was that the supernova demonstrated that even stars can undergo change. Then the telescope appeared. Through the telescope, the device revolutionized astronomy by making distant objects appear closer. Insufficiently distant to be distant versions of our Sun, it became increasingly absurd to consider heaven and earth as separate entities. Both are governed by identical rules. Isaac Newton demonstrated this in 1687 by demonstrating that his famous law of gravity applies to the moon and planets, similar to how apples fall from a tree. Newton explained how rainbows function, but it wasn't until 1802 that an English chemist named William Wollaston advanced the spectrum. By first passing sunlight through a narrow slit and then a prism, Wollaston improved the separation of colors. Then he observed that the sun's spectrum contained several thin, dark lines. Joseph Fraunhofer, a German instrument maker, invented a device for measuring the refraction of light through various types of glass in 1814. When used in sunlight, the device enabled Fraunhofer to observe the same dark spectrum lines as Wollaston. However, he witnessed hundreds more. Fraunhofer did not realize it at the time, but his invention, the spectroscope, would eventually be used to solve the mystery of the composition of the sun and stars. But only if someone could decipher the hidden message in those lines and transform a celestial barcode into a new astronomical knowledge. On the scientific path. There have always been instances when advancement appeared impossible. This was the situation in 1835 when the French philosopher Auguste Comte wrote that the chemical composition of the stars would forever be beyond human comprehension. Comte believed scientists would have to travel to the stars to determine their composition. However, thanks to the invention of the spectroscope, he was quickly disproved. The spectroscope separates light into distinct hues, ranging from red to vinyl. Additionally, it reveals that the sun's spectrum is riddled with thin, dark lines. The lines indicate specific wavelengths in which the sun's light has lost energy. However, where did it go? Given that light is a wave. In the 1850s, two German physicists, Robert Bunsen and Gustav Kirchhoff, collaborated to discover the answer. Experiments demonstrated that when light passes through a gas, the atoms in the gas absorb a portion of the light, but only at specific wavelengths that are dependent on the properties of each atom. This explains the absorption lines in the spectrum of the sun. Kirchhoff and Bunsen realized that the lines reveal which gases are present in the sun's atmosphere, serving as a chemical fingerprint. However, this is only half the story. When atoms are properly energized, they can emit light. This results in forming emission lines, the counterparts to absorption lines. These bright and dark spectral lines revealed a connection between the Earth and the sky to astronomers. First, they could measure the laboratory's spectra of gases and flames using known materials. Then, they could compare these findings to the sun's and stars' spectra. The chemistry of the universe was on display for the first time. William Huggins, an English astronomer, was among the first to attach a spectroscope to his telescope and explore the heavens in a new way beginning in 1862. Margaret, his wife and collaborator in science, later joined him at their home-built observatory near London. Huggins captured the spectra of numerous stars and other astronomical objects, Among his objectives was the Great Nebula in Orion, a hazy patch of light near the stars of Orion's belt. Huggins discovered that the nebula's spectrum was composed entirely of bright emission lines, particularly hydrogen. Evidence showed that the nebula was a vast cloud of glowing gas that could form new stars. Huggins observed something unusual in 1864 when he pointed his spectroscope at the Cine Nebula, an expanding shell of gas ejected from a dying star. The cat's eye emitted a bright green emission line that did not match any known element. Huggins referred to it as a mystery substance nebula. Over 60 years would pass before astronomers realized that the green line is produced by oxygen atoms with two electrons removed. This energized state reveals the nebula's high temperature and low pressure environment, which expanded at a speed of approximately 60,000 kilometers per hour in 1868. Indeed, the spectroscope led to the discovery of something entirely novel. French astronomer Jules Janssen utilized a spectroscope during a total solar eclipse in August of that year. Janssen hoped to isolate the light from a solar prominence, an ionized gas ribbon suspended in the sun's powerful magnetic field. Typically, prominences are invisible because the sun's surface is so brilliant. However, large prominences on the sun's edge are readily visible during a total eclipse. And when Janssen turned his spectroscope on one of them, he observed unidentified emission lines. In actuality, they did not match any known gases. Janssen soon discovered he could observe the same emission lines in the sun's spectrum without an eclipse. At the same time, an English astronomer named Norman Lockyer observed emission lines. You, like Janssen Loch, recognized that the lines were caused by a previously unidentified component. He named it helium after the Greek sun god Helios. The laboratory confirmation of the existence of helium would only occur 27 years later. But the discovery of the sun brought fame to Janssen and Loch. Lockyer went on to found the scientific journal Nature as its founding editor. By the end of the 19th century, the spectroscope had demonstrated its value in deciphering the sun's and stars' chemistry. However, its greatest victory was yet to come. In 1925, the quest to comprehend the composition of stars began, had come full circle. 24 centuries ago, Anaxagoras wrote that stars are fiery stones. Now, the spectroscope indicated a similar conclusion. By pointing it at the sun and distant stars, astronomers could observe spectral lines corresponding to sodium, calcium, magnesium, iron, and many other elements commonly found in Earth's minerals. This convinced the American astronomer Henry Norris Russell that, if heated to the sun's temperature, the Earth's crust would share its spectrum. Russell was a preeminent expert on stars, and his viewpoint shaped the scientific consensus. But Russell's universe was about to undergo a transformation. In an era before computers, a remarkable group of women in Cambridge, Massachusetts, were hired to work at the Harvard College Observatory, laying the groundwork for this change. The director of the observatory, E.E. Pickering, dealt with a massive influx of new cosmic data. The advent of photography and spectroscopy enabled the capture and recording of the spectra of thousands of stars on photographic plates. It was a data glut, and Pickering required assistance. Moreover, he required the funds to hire an army of astronomers. Thus, in 1881, Pickering hired Wilhelmina Fleming as his housekeeper. Fleming was a former teacher in Scotland, and she quickly mastered the skill of cataloguing stars based on their spectral lines. She devised a classification system and inspected 10,000 individual stars on photographic plates. Pickering hired additional women as assistants and placed Fleming in charge. They would lay the foundations for modern astrophysics over the next 30 years. Annie Jump Cannon was one of the team's most influential members when she arrived at the observatory in 1896. Cannon became proficient at cataloguing stars based on their spectra as she gained experience. At her best, she could catalogue 3 stars per minute. In her lifetime, she is estimated to have classified approximately 500,000 stars by eye, more than anyone else in history. As she worked, Cannon discovered a more advanced system for classifying stars. As one moved from star type to star type, her approach revealed a progression in the spectral lines, with some lines becoming stronger and others fading away. This was a crucial clue, but only an astronomer would comprehend it. Cecilia Page grew up in England, where she became interested in astronomy. She soon discovered, however, that opportunities for women in astronomy were practically non-existent. Payne arrived at the Harvard College Observatory in 1923 to enroll in the newly established graduate program. Working with Kennan's data, Payne began to understand the physics underlying the classification scheme. She realized that a spectrum can be used to determine the temperature of a star. At various temperatures, stars uniquely energize the atoms of various elements, resulting in a distinct set of spectral lines. But Payne's analysis revealed something else as well. Hydrogen appeared to be the most abundant component in all stars. Payne summarized her findings in her doctoral dissertation in 1925. But after reading an advance copy, Henry Norris Russell believed her hydrogen conclusion was incorrect. Payne then added a sentence undermining her most daring discovery to the thesis. Within 4 years, Russell recognized and admitted his error. The astonishing insight of Cecilia Payne was correct. According to astronomers, hydrogen is the most abundant element in stars, which points to a unique scientific story. Like the Orion Nebula, which William Huggins once studied, stars are formed from clouds of hydrogen gas. The radiance of the stars results from nuclear reactions that convert hydrogen into helium and heavier elements. Eventually, stars expire and the elements they generate are returned to space. They are identical to their appearance in the Cat's Eye Nebula. The stars provide the raw materials required to create planets and life. This is the great secret revealed by the spectroscope. Over a century, remarkable men and women uncovered a secret. Thanks to them, we now understand the composition of stars. In a genuine sense, however, we have also discovered that we are composed of stars. When observing the night sky, it is simple to be awed by the magnitude of our universe. It's not simply that the space is vast, our place in it is so insignificant. And as our understanding of the universe has expanded, so has the realization that most of it is inhospitable to life. It is evident that life as we know it can only survive by clinging to the few rocky planets fortunate enough to exist in the narrow zone between too hot and too cold. While the remainder of the universe can be breathtakingly gorgeous, it is completely indifferent to our existence. But what if the opposite is true? What if everything exists because we do? It is referred to as the anthropic principle. It is the notion that our cosmos is a product of our existence. Some cosmologists assert that this may be the only way to explain why the universe is as it is. In antiquity, the universe required no such explanation. With so much order and complexity, assuming that a divine being was responsible was logical. However, philosophers in ancient Greece followed a different path. They attempted to explain the cosmos using natural laws. Consequently, they frequently required corrections regarding the origins of various phenomena and our place in the universe. Aristotle, for instance, argued that the Earth must be the center of the universe with the stars and planets revolving around it. However, while this conclusion was incorrect, Aristotle and other philosophers laid the groundwork for modern science by emphasizing observation and reasoning. It was a process that spanned centuries. By the early 1500s, however, our understanding of the universe had begun to emerge. Nicolaus Copernicus, a Polish church official and administrator, who was also a brilliant astronomer, took the crucial step. Copernicus realized that the planet's motions made much more sense if the Sun, not the Earth, was at the center of the solar system. The scientific revolution began with the publication of Copernicus's ideas after he died in 1543. Initially, not only was the Copernican system controversial for religious reasons, but it also defied common sense. Ultimately, the Earth is the focal point for any observer standing on solid ground and gazing at the night sky. However, the crowning achievement of Copernicus was developing a more profound logic for the natural order of things. It makes little sense for the Earth to be at the center of the universe, as this would imply that humans have lived in the most special place for centuries. Since the adoption of what is now known as the Copernican principle by astronomers, our place in the universe is unlikely to be unique. Instead, we experience the universe in a manner comparable to that of other observers. This premise became the bedrock of modern cosmology in the 20th century. Once astronomers realized that almost all galaxies were moving away from us, the Copernican principle paved the way for a startling discovery. It's not that galaxies are receding from a particular location because we happen to be there. As the universe expands, galaxies must move away from one another. Our location may have specific details, but the universe appears identical regardless of location. As telescopes advanced, the Copernican principle remained consistent with the growing body of evidence. The universe is filled with galaxies similar to ours, spanning billions of light years in all directions. We are not at the center of the universe, nor is anyone else, because as far as we can tell, there is neither a center nor a preferred direction of view. However, cosmologists began to notice something peculiar. While our perspective of the universe may not be exceptional, the universe itself is remarkable. Our reality is unique due to the physical laws that govern it. And as cosmologists began to examine these laws more closely, they moved in a new direction, diverging for the first time in nearly 500 years from Copernicus's theory. Our universe is an extraordinarily diverse place. From our solar system's planets to distant galaxies, they consist of the characteristics of elementary particles and the forces that operate between them. Even though these rules explain a great deal, there must be additional explanations for why they are so perfectly arranged to produce a universe that can support life. Consider gravity as an example. Compared to all other natural forces, it is fragile. This is why a toy magnet can easily overcome the Earth's gravity and lift a paperclip. But if gravity were significantly stronger, the outcome would be disastrous. The matter contained within stars would be tightly packed in such a universe. A slight increase in the force of gravity would accelerate nuclear reactions and cause stars to burn out sooner. However, if gravity were significantly weaker, stars would not shine. Consequently, no star would endure long enough for life to evolve. Similarly, particle physics is filled with random numbers and relationships upon which our existence depends. For instance, the neutron and proton are nearly identical in mass, but the neutron is 0.19% heavier. If only the converse were true. Without subatomic particles, atoms would not exist. A subtler example suggests that our universe is ideal for forming carbon-based life, the only known life form. Carbon atoms can readily form long chains, essential for large organic molecules, the type of molecules required to construct functional cells. However, carbon only forms in stars. And when physicists began to determine precisely how this occurred, they discovered an intriguing mystery. The nucleus of a carbon atom is composed of 12 particles, 6 protons, and 6 neutrons. Initially composed of helium, carbon is synthesized by stars from helium. Every helium nucleus is composed of 2 protons and 2 neutrons. Helium and nitrogen combine to produce the element beryllium-8. Beryllium-8 will disintegrate in less than a quadrillionth of a second unless an additional helium atom is added to the stars. That occurs frequently enough. But there is a problem. Too much energy is produced when beryllium and helium are combined. Instead of producing carbon, they must separate. In 1953, the British astronomer Fred Hoyle discovered a solution to this issue. He hypothesized that a form of excited carbon existed that closely matched the higher energy level of beryllium plus helium. Hoyle was accurate. Soon after his prediction, the excited carbon state was found. It greatly increases the likelihood that beryllium and helium will transform into carbon after combining. However, why is the energized state of carbon optimal for this to occur? To comprehend why this is problematic, consider pressing the emergency button to halt a speeding lift. The door then opens, revealing that the lift has stopped precisely on the floor where people can exit. In other words, it is pure chance. Despite this, we owe our existence to a coincidence. Over the years, physicists have encountered additional instances in which we would not exist if the numbers were altered slightly. Nobody would be present. This understanding has led us to the anthropic principle. The phrase was coined in 1973 by the Australian cosmologist Brandon Carter, who divided the anthropic principle into two versions. The argument that our place and time in the universe are unique because they are compatible with the existence of life is the weakest version. We would not be here to experience it if it were not true. However, a stronger version suggests the universe cannot exist unless it permits life to evolve. Otherwise, the physical laws are too coincidental. As soon as Carter formulated these definitions, it was evident that the anthropic principle challenged the conventional scientific method. Since Copernicus, astronomers have assumed that the universe exists apart from our presence. With this premise in mind, numerous cosmologists resisted the anthropic principle, hoping that scientific progress would eventually lead to a better understanding of natural laws. The anthropic principle and a stunning theory regarding the true nature of our cosmos were then brought back into the spotlight by an unexpected development. In 1998, astronomers made a discovery that forever altered our understanding of the universe. They discovered evidence of dark energy, a mysterious phenomenon that pervades all of space and accelerates the universe's expansion. This is important news because it helps explain everything from the universe's age to its distant future. However, dark energy has significant implications for the anthropic principle. Of all the cosmic coincidences that make our universe hospitable to life, there are countless. The most significant coincidence is the existence of dark energy. Due to the low density of dark energy, this is the case, a minuscule fraction of a fraction, greater than zero. So far, nothing in the physical laws explains why dark energy density should be so low. It appears entirely arbitrary. However, the expansion would have been too rapid for galaxies to form if there had been a little more dark energy in the early universe. Without galaxies, stars, planets, and the possibility of life would not exist. This is a philosophical problem for scientists, as it is difficult to explain a universe that appears to have been created specifically for us. In some religious circles, the discovery of dark energy is now used as evidence for the existence of a divine creator. Scientists have found, however, consider the Earth's position in our solar system from a different perspective. Earth is uniquely advantageous for life among the planets. Closer proximity to the Sun would result in excessive heat. If it were slightly further away, it would be too chilly. Therefore, Earth has no reason to be at the optimal distance from the Sun for life to thrive. Consequently, is this another instance in which scientists must consider the anthropic principle? No, for self-evident reasons. Who? There are additional planets in our solar system, there are numerous additional planets, and numerous others have been found around other stars. The Milky Way is estimated to contain billions of planets, each with its own characteristics and temperature. That implies that Earth is not a coincidence, it is merely one of the countless possibilities. And since we can only exist on planets similar to Earth, this is the type of planet we inhabit. Now, cosmologists are employing the same logic to address the anthropic principle. Because what if there are other universes? What if there are multiple universes with similar physical laws that are coincidentally optimal for life? What if there are infinite universes in which the physical laws can take any form? This expanded view of reality has become so compelling that cosmologists have named it. It is known as the multiverse. If this is true, our universe, however vast it may appear, is merely a bubble in a multidimensional cosmos where other universes constantly form, each with its own dark energy value. Since only a small fraction of these universes would be habitable, it is not a coincidence that we inhabit one. This is a shocking conclusion. And even though it has not been proven, two research fields support it. The first is string theory. It is a mathematical method for explaining the laws of nature with multiple potential solutions. According to some theorists, each solution corresponds to a unique universe in the multiverse. Secondly, scientists investigating the early universe have discovered that what they observe is consistent with the theory of cosmic inflation. Our universe is believed to have originated from a small region of space that released energy by expanding exponentially. If correct, other universes in an eternally expanding multiverse should behave similarly. There are numerous reasons to be wary of this photograph. This implies, among other things, that we must conjure numerous parallel universes to explain this. And if this is true, there will never be a single set of physical laws capable of predicting our reality. Because all alternate realities are equally possible in the multiverse. This image may be our only means of explaining astronomers' discoveries due to the multiverse. The anthropic principle is central to history's most fascinating scientific debates. It is a debate that involves everything we know and can know about the universe. We do not yet know where this debate will lead, but it will undoubtedly be influenced by what we discover as astronomers continue to explore the universe's boundaries. In the meantime, we already know that, contrary to the Copernican principle, our perspective on the universe is unique in one respect. Since it's only. In our lifetime, humanity will finally have the means to reveal how diverse and potentially vast the cosmos is. In the 19th century, astronomers confirmed that our solar system is situated within a galaxy of stars, shaped like a giant disk. This explains why, when viewed along the Milky Way, it appears to us as a glowing band of light extending across the sky. We are examining the disk. However, astronomers were only partially content with this early galaxy image. The solar system had to be located near the center of the Milky Way, for starters. It was an improbable coincidence, and with a way to measure the precise distances between the stars, it was possible to determine how accurate this galaxy image was, to acquire a deeper comprehension of the Milky Way. Astronomers require innovative tools and concepts. By 1912, both were present. Unanticipatedly, the new concept was a method for directly measuring distances in deep space. Henrietta Leavitt was one of several women employed by the Harvard College Observatory to perform mathematical calculations before the invention of electronics. Astronomers could now calculate the star's actual brightness and determine its distance by comparing it to its apparent brightness in the sky. The method was quickly implemented with the assistance of the most powerful telescope in astronomy, a 60-inch reflector atop Mount Wilson near Los Angeles. Harlow Shapley, a former crime reporter turned astronomer, would make galactic history with the telescope's unprecedented power. With the massive telescope, Shapley examined globular clusters, distant concentrations of stars with distinct spherical shapes. Each globular cluster contains thousands to millions of stars that orbit one another like a swarm of bees. Shapley believed that these clusters, in turn, must orbit the Milky Way's gravitational core. By utilizing Cepheid variables to measure the distances to the clusters, Shapley could determine the location of a point in space where all the clusters appear to be concentrated. The outcome altered everything. It revealed that the actual center of the Milky Way is located tens of thousands of light years away in the direction of Sagittarius. The revelation was a cosmic wake-up call for astronomers. Nicholas Copernicus removed the Earth from the center of the solar system and placed the Sun there centuries ago. Shipley's turn was to move the solar system away from the Milky Way's center. The discovery of Champlain relegated humanity to the outskirts of a galaxy much larger than anyone had imagined. Astronomers currently estimate that the Milky Way is wider than 100,000 light years. Yet even in Shapley's time, there was mounting evidence that this vastly enlarged Milky Way was merely a minuscule portion of a vastly more expansive cosmic reality. As telescopes improved, a class of faint, fuzzy objects strewn across the night sky came into focus as proof of alien life. Many looked like little spindles. Others were uniquely spiral-shaped. Some believe these faint spirals are infant solar systems forming within the Milky Way. However, a more radical possibility existed as well. Could they be other galaxies similar to the Milky Way that are far away in the cosmos? Early in the 20th century, astronomer Edwin Hubble demonstrated the affirmative. Using the newly constructed 100-inch telescope at Mount Wilson, Hubble zoomed in on the Great Nebula in Andromeda, the most prominent mysterious spiral. He identified the Cepheid variables, the pulsating stars that would prove crucial again. This time, they permitted Hubble to calculate the precise Andromeda distance. The era of interstellar exploration was about to commence. In the mid-1920s, astronomers realized that galaxies populate the universe like islands in a cosmic sea. Each galaxy is a separate system containing hundreds of billions of stars. However, this discovery raises several questions about our galaxy, the Milky Way. Was it a spiral system visible from a distance? And if that is the case, how would we know? It took astronomers centuries to determine that the Milky Way is shaped like a large disk, with the solar system located approximately two-thirds of the way from the center. Now the difficulty was to map the Milky Way from within. This was a complex task. Dust is a major contributor to the issue. Even ancient astronomers could see that the Milky Way is not uniformly distributed across the night sky. Instead, it appears uneven and patchy. In some spots, it is separated by dark rifts. This is because the Milky Way is interwoven with vast clouds of interstellar dust, which obscure our view of most of the galaxy. Nevertheless, despite this visual barrier, astronomers could determine the shape of our galaxy thanks to certain clues. American astronomer William Morgan was one of the first to investigate these clues. In 1951, Morgan researched blue supergiant stars, the hottest and brightest stars in the galaxy, at the Yerkes Observatory located northwest of Chicago. Morgan realized that the double cluster and the massive stars traced a line through space, indicating the presence of a structure within the Milky Way. He had discovered one of the grand spiral arms of our galaxy, the Perseus arm. Shortly after, it was discovered that other Milky Way landmarks were also part of the Perseus arm. Among them is the magnificent Crab Nebula, the remnant of a 1054 supernova explosion. But there should be more spiral arms if there is only one. By looking in the opposite direction from Perseus, astronomers discovered a second arm closer to the galaxy's center. This is the arm of Sagittarius. Consequently, the southern Milky Way contains a dazzling array of star clusters and nebulae. This portion of the sky is a visual paradise due to the magnificent nebula and other dazzling sights. Astronomers have determined that our solar system is a portion of Orion's arm, a smaller structure that may be nothing more than a stub extending from Sagittarius. Yet, the Orion arm too is replete with breathtaking sights which dominate our view due to their proximity. Looking down the length of Orion's arm, we see the closest and most spectacular star-forming region to us, the Great Nebula in Orion, where tens of thousands of new stars are born right before our eyes. Using radio telescopes and infrared satellites that can see through the obscuring dust of galaxies, astronomers have now mapped the structure of the Milky Way. It is much more difficult to discern from Earth, but astronomers have discovered it contains massive clusters of hot young stars. The view is completed by the smaller spiral arms that wind between the larger ones, including the one where our solar system resides. This is a perspective no telescope can provide, but is supported by years of observation across the Milky Way. Mapping our galaxy is one of astronomy's most notable accomplishments. However, it is more than a map. It is a snapshot of a dynamic star system whose history spans billions of years and is directly relevant to our existence. In this sense, the spiral may be the ultimate cosmic symbol of life, as new stars and planets are born in spiral galaxies. The exact process led to our solar system's formation in the Milky Way. In this way, the spiral may represent the ultimate cosmic symbol of life. 4. New stars and planets are born within spiral galaxies, and occasionally, civilizations like ours desire to map and explore the surrounding universe. Few human experiences are as inspiring as a night sky filled with stars. Throughout history, the nighttime view of the universe has inspired our imagination. It has contributed to the creation of great art and profound insights. However, only some of the most imaginative works of fiction can compete with what science has revealed regarding the universe's origin. The narrative begins with a bang. Welcome to the Big Bang, the energetic explosion that initiated the expansion of space and the formation of all matter at the beginning of cosmic history. This is our starting point. The discovery of such a beginning is one of the greatest scientific achievements of the 20th century. Now, the challenge of comprehending it has begun. Every great civilization throughout history has a unique origin story. The explanation provides the response to the question: how did everything get here? In that, it evokes a vision of supreme forces and extraordinary events beyond human experience. The Big Bang theory shares many similarities with these tales. The difference is that the Big Bang theory is supported by evidence that can be found everywhere if one knows where to look. This is the Planck satellite for Europe, initiated in 2009. It is an orbiting time traveler that has traveled 13 billion years to bring us to the Big Bang. Planck has provided the most comprehensive view of a pivotal moment when light could travel freely through space and carry information about the universe's beginning. Planck probed the cosmos in all directions to obtain this view, creating a map of the entire sky. However, this map does not depict a familiar scene of galaxies and stars. Behind everything else is the faint signal from the darkness beyond the cosmic background. This was a candid look at the universe when it was only 380,000 years old, a tiny fraction of its present age. On the surface, such a view may appear impossible because it implies that we can observe events before Earth's existence. However, this is possible due to the finite speed of light. Light is the fastest known natural phenomenon. It travels through space at nearly 300,000 kilometers per second. At that rate, it takes only 1.3 seconds for the light from the moon to reach Earth. That is extremely quick. However, this still implies that we look into the past when we gaze at the moon, a path that occurred on the surface of the moon 1.3 seconds ago. Saturn is significantly more distant than the moon, so its light takes longer to reach us. When observing Saturn's rings through a telescope, we look back by more than an hour. Beyond our solar system, however, the distinction between the past and the present becomes striking. Here are the Pleiades, a brilliant star cluster 400 light-years away. In other words, when we see the Pleiades, we see them as 400 years ago when Galileo recorded his first telescope view of them. But our ability to travel through time becomes remarkable once we look beyond the Milky Way galaxy. The Andromeda galaxy is the farthest visible object. It is more than 2.5 million light-years distant. Therefore, our view of Andromeda represents the galaxy's appearance 2.5 million years ago. Long before the first Homo sapiens walked the Earth, this occurred. Such a duration is unfathomable on a human scale. On a cosmic scale, however, it is a small distance. We observe countless galaxies tens or hundreds of millions of light-years away as we probe deeper into space using powerful telescopes. We can now discern the light of galaxies that are 12 billion light-years away as we continue to push the limits of our visibility. Observing them allows us to see more than 90% of the distance back to the Big Bang. Beyond this point, there are no more galaxies to observe because galaxies are still forming at such a distant and ancient time. However, we can look further, to a time when the light did not originate from stars or galaxies, but rather from the glowing haze of hot gas that filled the universe after the Big Bang. The Planck satellite has brought us here. Here, we can find the clues that will deepen our comprehension of the Big Bang. Before 13.5 billion years ago, the universe had a very different appearance than today. A few hundred thousand years after the Big Bang, space was filled with particles that were still too energetic to form atoms. Today, this map from the Planck satellite to the human eye reveals the imprint of this early period in cosmic history on the heavens. The map lacks a discernible pattern. However, when mathematically analyzed, these colored specks precisely measure the universe's fundamental properties and give a window into the Big Bang. The key to comprehending the map is recognizing that it is a record of temperatures. It depicts a universe in the process of cooling off from its blazing infancy. Red represents regions of space that were slightly warmer than average in the distant past, while blue represents slightly colder regions. These distinctions are akin to cosmic seeds, as they allow matter to accumulate in some regions of space while leaving others predominantly empty. The vast clusters of galaxies surrounding us today result from this primordial matter clustering. However, if Planck can recall when space was filled with white hot gas, why is the sky not white now? The answer to this question challenges one of our most fundamental universe-related intuitions, the notion that it has always existed. In ancient times, gazing into the heavens was akin to confronting eternity. This may be because, on Earth, time brings about both growth and decay. Therefore, the stars appear timeless from above. Aristotle, the most influential ancient philosopher, believed he had demonstrated the eternity of the universe. The idea that there could have been nothing before there was something offended his very sense of reason. But shortly after Isaac Newton discovered his law of gravity, an issue with eternity arose. All stars must be attracted to one another due to gravity. Nonetheless, why haven't the stars converged if the universe is eternal? Until the 1920s, this question lingered uncomfortably for more than two centuries. By that time, Albert Einstein had developed a new theory of gravity, and astronomers had realized that stars are grouped into galaxies and that galaxies are dispersed throughout space. However, the question of eternity persisted indefinitely. All galaxies should have been drawn together by gravity to avoid this contradiction. So Einstein modified his equations to counteract the gravitational influence throughout space. But Einstein quickly realized that his efforts were unnecessary. Following the work of other astronomers, Edwin Hubble announced in 1929 that most galaxies were moving away from our own. He discovered this by separating the light from each galaxy into a rainbow-like spectrum. Any receding object will appear to emit light that is shifted towards the red end of the spectrum. That is exactly what Hubble observed. And the greater a galaxy's distance, the faster it appeared to recede. According to Hubble and subsequent scientists, the most logical explanation is that space is expanding and dragging galaxies along with it. On a human scale, the universe's expansion occurs too slowly for us to detect. In 10 years, every square meter of space expands by the diameter of a single atom. That is insufficient to overcome the gravity that holds stars together, so neither the Milky Way nor we are growing significantly. In the vast void between galaxies, however, the expansion of space is accelerating, resulting in a rapid separation of galaxies. It also implies that the galaxies we observe today would have been much closer together if we had traveled back in time. And at some point in the past, there would not have been any stars or galaxies, only a continuous glow of hot matter. The universe is observed by the Planck satellite. Today, however, space has expanded so much that the light from this early period has been redshifted beyond the human eye's range, beyond the infrared, and has become a signal in the microwave portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. This signal was discovered by accident in 1964 when two radio astronomers from Bell Labs, Robert Wilson and Arno Penzias, pointed an antenna towards the heavens and could not comprehend why the entire sky was emitting microwaves without their knowledge. They discovered cosmic background evidence suggesting that the universe as we know it is not eternal but had a beginning in time, a Big Bang. However, more was to come. As the space age flourished, so did the realization that this ancient message was key to understanding our cosmic origins. According to the Big Bang theory, today's universe was created from a white-hot mixture of particles that cooled to form atoms, stars, and galaxies. Due to the expansion of the universe, however, this brilliant beginning has faded. Fortunately, it can still be found as a cosmic microwave background, originating from all directions in space, and the best place to observe it is in space. Thus, NASA launched COBE, the Cosmic Background Explorer, in 1989. Its mission was to detect the cosmic background and determine whether it could reveal crucial information about the universe's evolution. The assignment was challenging. Previous studies using aircraft at high altitudes have demonstrated that the cosmic background is remarkably uniform throughout the sky. Yet, somehow, that uniform glow of the distant past gave way to the present-day universe, which consists of vast galaxies surrounded by vast voids of empty space. So, as Kobe began to map the entire cosmos's background, scientists hunted for subtle differences concealed within the ancient universe's smoothness. In this Kobe image, they discovered a remarkable confirmation of the Big Bang. The cosmic background appears spotted, with temperature variations on the order of 0.01 of a degree. The researchers were overjoyed. Even though these variations were minute, they allowed Kobe to detect the earliest indications of large-scale structure in the universe. In addition, it implied that the cosmic background could serve as a link to an even more remote past. When the universe was only a fraction of a second old, the blotches were the remnants of momentary energy fluctuations. As the universe expanded, however, these minute fluctuations grew to enormous proportions, leaving their imprint on the cosmic microwave background. Kobe revealed the cosmic background's power as a window into the Big Bang. Now, scientists desire additional knowledge. Wilkinson began work on the Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe WMAP for short in June 2001, following Kobe NASA's success. The WMAP was created to image the cosmos background, but in much greater detail. The astonishing result would test theories regarding how the Big Bang occurred. Planck was constructed to survey the cosmic background at a wider range of wavelengths and with greater precision than WMAP. The WMAP advanced our understanding of the Big Bang, but the Planck mission will take us further. The map confirmed that most of the universe's mass consists of invisible, undiscovered particles heavier than those comprising stars and galaxies. After more than 15 months of scanning, scientists began meticulously removing layers to reveal an ultra-sensitive view. Within the image, nearby microwave sources had to be subtracted. Scientists extracted all the energy from distant sources within the Milky Way plane and from the wispy dust clouds that pervade our galaxy. The cosmic background itself was observed for the first time ever. The outcome was a success. As soon as it was published in March 2013, it was evident that the new map provided a remarkable portrait of the universe in complex numbers. Pronk also provided a breakdown of how ordinary matter, such as stars and galaxies, is distributed throughout the universe. Dark matter, which emits no light, accounts for most of the universe's mass. A third component, known as dark energy, causes the expansion of space to accelerate over time. These numbers are crucial because they allow cosmologists to distinguish between various Big Bang theory variants. Today, the predominant theory regarding the universe's origin is inflation. According to this theory, a release of energy from the space vacuum caused the universe to expand exponentially in the first trillionth, trillionth, trillionth of a second after the Big Bang. Inflation explains why the universe appears so similar across all distances. According to scientists working on Planck, it disproves some versions of inflation while being consistent with others. However, there are alternative theories, including the notion that the universe we know today is part of a cosmic cycle that repeats. If so, other universes may have existed before this one. To distinguish between these possibilities, scientists are currently searching for indications that gravitational waves generated by the Big Bang have left their mark on the cosmic background. In the meantime, the most significant result of the Planck mission is that the cosmological background appears mathematically simple at multiple scales. This may be telling us something genuine about the cosmos. A universe that began with a bang, but has evolved into a symphony of forms and phenomena 150 million kilometers away from Earth. A universe that may have begun, but has evolved into a truly inspiring place. The Sun provides all of the required stars. Its energy is responsible for our atmosphere's turbulence, keeps our oceans liquid, and makes life possible. Imagine if the Sun were 3 times larger and blasted every exposed surface with 10 times as much energy. Then Earth would be a significantly different place. A universe governed by heat and light, similar to Mercury, with its sloping and beaten surface. Mercury appears to be a no-man's land among the planets, but it is precisely this no-man's land that scientists must investigate. Mercury, the closest planet to the Sun, resides in a cosmic hot zone containing crucial information about our solar system's origins. And it may be the key to comprehending the conditions of countless alien worlds dispersed across the galaxy. Unfortunately, Mercury evaded astronomers' efforts to uncover its secrets for centuries. The reason is based on geometry as observed from Earth. The maximum angle between Mercury and the Sun is 30 degrees. After sunset, or just before sunrise, the only way to distinguish the planet from the Sun's blinding glare is to look very low towards the horizon. Before the dawn of the space age, even the world's largest optical telescopes could not reveal any surface details on Mercury under such conditions. All of that changed with the launch of Mariner 10 in 1973. This courageous spacecraft was originally intended to fly by Venus, but scientists realized they could get two planets for the price of one by also targeting Mercury. Mariner 10 made three passes of Mercury between 1974 and 1975, coming within 327 kilometers of the planet's surface on its third and final approach. During these historical encounters, centuries of speculation about the solar system's innermost world were replaced by a starkly different picture. Mariner 10 revealed a heavily cratered planet that resembled the Moon in appearance. The majority of craters on Mercury date back billions of years because the planet is too small and hot to support a dense atmosphere. Its surface is impervious to wind and water erosion. Yet, hidden within this ancient surface are tantalizing indications that Mercury has changed over the aeons and that Mercury is fundamentally different despite its outward resemblance to the Moon. One indicator is the planet's surprising mass. Mercury is nearly five times more massive than the Moon, despite its diameter being only 40% larger. Mercury must conceal a massive metallic core covered by a relatively thin layer of lighter rock to be so dense. Mariner 10's discovery that Mercury has a magnetic field, albeit much weaker than Earth's, further supported this theory. The presence of the field indicates that at least a portion of Mercury's core remains liquid. Mariner 10 attempted to glean additional information from its reconnaissance of Mercury, but during its three fast passes, it captured images of less than half of the planet's surface. And its findings left numerous questions unanswered. A second mission to Mercury, designed for a much longer stay, was required, even though Mercury was calling. The desire to return would go unfulfilled for nearly 30 years. NASA's Messenger spacecraft finally launched on August 3, 2004, to become the first planetary probe to orbit Mercury and reveal its detailed features and characteristics. Getting there would be half the challenge, however. Mercury is much closer to Earth than most other planets in our solar system, but it also resides deep within the Sun's gravitational field, causing it to travel through space at a significantly different speed, approximately 65,000 kilometers per hour faster than Earth. It would first need to match the speed of the planets to enter Mercury's orbit rather than sail by messenger. The spacecraft would paradoxically lose energy as it gradually approached the Sun. The journey would take over 6.5 years to complete. Messenger passed by Mercury three times, allowing scientists to test the camera and sensor capabilities of the probe. The results were astounding, but the brief glimpses only whetted the scientists' appetite for more information. In March 2011, Messenger made its fourth and final approach to Mercury, moving at the optimal speed to be captured by the planet's gravitational pull. Messenger enabled the long-awaited exploration of the solar system's innermost planet to commence. Mercury finally had its moment in the spotlight. Ancient astronomers named the elusive and swiftly moving planet Mercury after the god's messenger. But it would not be until 2011 that NASA's Messenger mission could reveal one of the least explored worlds in the solar system. A messenger came prepared for the task. Mercury's sunlight is so intense that an unprotected spacecraft would quickly be destroyed. So Messenger has thermal insulation and an integrated system of radiators designed to remove heat from its sensitive electronics. Two-thirds of its solar panel's surface area is reflective to deflect rather than absorb solar energy and aid in temperature control, Scientists anticipated that the precautions would allow Messenger to survive at least 1 year in Mercury's hostile environment. As Messenger began to reveal the planet's complex geology, however, they desired more information. With both a wide and a narrow angle, the camera Messenger could map the entire surface of Mercury down to features measuring 1 kilometer across, and zoom in on areas of particular interest to see details measuring 20 meters across. The camera system could also detect color variations in Mercury's rocky terrain that are too subtle for the human eye to perceive. This would be useful for reconstructing the complex history revealed by Mercury's craters, and there were numerous craters to examine on the Moon. Mercury has a long-standing tradition of naming craters after scientists and philosophers. Instead, craters should be given the names of renowned artists, composers, and authors. Even though Mercury's craters share a common affinity for the arts, Messenger quickly uncovered striking differences. Messenger focuses on two adjacent craters, Dega and Bronte, as the human eye sees. They appear identical, but Messenger reveals that Dagon has a bluer hue than Bronte. This difference suggests that Mercury's surface is composed of distinct layers of igneous material. In this instance, the impact has penetrated a blue or colored rock beneath the brown rock. Elsewhere, scientists could only discern a rich and diverse geologic past after Messenger's arrival because the color variations are more complex. Occasionally, the impact of an asteroid or comet is visible because it scatters bright rays of material across an older set of features. However, not all of Mercury's surface is shaped by an external force. In this intriguing photograph, an orange smudge stands out against a landscape depicted in a close-up in black and white. The object at the center of the haze appears to be a tall window into a crater. However, this is not a typical crater. Instead, it is probably the result of a volcanic eruption spewing orange-colored material from the planet's interior. Messenger has confirmed that Mercury is covered with features such as this one, which could only have been caused by volcanic activity. Here, the Falkner crater appears to be partially submerged in the landscape. This is because lava likely flooded the crater, which topped its old rim and partially filled it with molten rock. The outer ring of the large crater Rachmaninoff is greater than 30 kilometers in diameter. Differences in hue indicate that lava flooded the crater's center long after it formed and spread into the inner and outer rings. In other instances, Mercury's surface colors are difficult to interpret. Some crater floors, for instance, contain bright hollows that stand out against the darker rock and are unlike anything else on the Moon. The exact nature of these bright patches is unknown, but scientists believe they may result from certain minerals becoming gaseous in the intense sunlight. It is by far the most significant planetary impact feature. Colossus was formed when a massive asteroid struck Mercury during the first billion years of the solar system's history. Over time, other smaller craters scarred the basin. The basins of the vast central plain were then covered by lava, leaving the raised rims of the smaller craters to stand out like blue islands. In contrast, the edge of the enormous basin is marked with orange spots where molten lava found its way to the surface through the fractured bedrock. In the center of the Colossus basin, Messenger has discovered a strange network of troughs that spreads across the base and floor like a spider's web. This is evidence that the basin's surface may have been stretched or pulled in the past. Mercury's large metallic core leaves little room for doubt that it was once a geologically active planet and has remained so since its formation. Now, with the help of Messenger's trove of images and data, scientists are gaining a deeper understanding of the unseen forces beneath Mercury's cratered surface. A newly discovered world, hundreds of light years from Earth, basks in the intense light of an alien sun. This is one of the numerous planets discovered by NASA's Kepler mission, which was designed to search for Earth-like planets that are small, rocky, and far enough from their stars to support liquid water. Kepler, however, discovered many planets similar to Mercury that orbited much closer to their stars than those previously identified by planetary explorers. Mercury is, therefore, our best point of reference for comprehending the countless other hot worlds that populate our galaxy by the billions. Additionally, of special interest to scientists. Are these Mercury characteristics unique in the solar system? Hundreds of kilometers of towering cliffs stretch across Mercury's ravaged terrain. One of these cliffs bisects the ancient Remo, with one side of the crater being 2 kilometers higher than the other. Having captured images of Mercury's entire surface, NASA's Messenger spacecraft has confirmed that these cliffs are widespread across the planet. They are now believed to form as Mercury's massive metallic core cooled and shrank gradually. This caused the planet's outer shell to be oversized. As a result, the planet's surface buckled as its interior shrank, creating cliffs resembling giant creases in a planet-wide shrink wrap. The cliffs illustrate how internal forces have shaped Mercury's external appearance. In addition, as scientists combine messenger data with ground-based radar measurements, the dynamic nature of Mercury's interior is becoming clearer. Mercury's metallic core, which accounts for 85% of the planet's total diameter, is a fundamental discovery because it is even larger than anticipated. However, while the inner portion of the core likely consists of solid iron, at least a portion of the outer core must be liquid. Mercury's magnetic field is produced by the motions within this electrically charged liquid. However, this image poses a dilemma for scientists. If Mercury's core is composed solely of iron, it should have solidified completely. This has led scientists to hypothesize that Mercury's core contains significant amounts of lighter elements, such as silicon and sulfur, which would lower the core's melting point and leave the outer portion liquid. Mercury's liquid core may even be encircled by a shell of solid iron sulfide, which has never been observed on any other planet. Even though this explanation explains the data, it reveals a deeper mystery. According to another theory, in the solar system's early days, the Sun went through a much hotter phase and boiled off some of Mercury's mantle with its intense heat. However, recent research contradicts both of these hypotheses. Instead, Mercury may have formed due to its small size and abundance of lighter elements, once considered scarce so close to the Sun. Regardless of the explanation, there is something about Mercury's history and the solar system's formation that we still need to comprehend. And this is not the only way Mercury defies expectations, as Messenger has also discovered ice on this world that is so thoroughly baked by the Sun. Radar observations indicated a highly reflective material near the planet's north and south poles, indicating the existence of ice on Mercury, despite the difficulty of imagining it. As Mercury rotates on its axis, there are deep craters at its poles whose bottoms remain in perpetual darkness. The absence of direct sunlight. These craters serve as icy traps for water vapor brought to Mercury by comets that collide with the planet's surface. Messenger detected the presence of ice with a neutron spectrometer, which measures how much the ice absorbs the energy of incoming cosmic rays, despite the inability of its cameras to see inside these craters with dark bottoms. Mercury has repeatedly proven to be a fantastic place, not just a hotter version of our moon, but a fascinating world in its own right, with a history essential to our understanding of all rocky planets. The European and Japanese space agencies have joined forces to send a second mission to Mercury, which will arrive at the start of the following decade. Mercury was once the planet that was least understood. Today, it is one of the most intriguing representatives of the vast population of newly discovered worlds that constitute the cosmic hot zone. Far beyond the Milky Way, a tiny particle of matter shoots through the void of space like a bullet. The particle, propelled by immense forces, moves at nearly the speed of light, zipping past stars and the glowing gas clouds where stars are born. Suddenly, a planet that cannot be stopped appears directly before us. The high-energy particle rips through the atmosphere of the planet. It collides with an atom of nitrogen, destroying both particles in a flash of pure energy. This energy generates new particles that cascade downward, resulting in additional collisions. Soon, thousands, then millions of other particles dispersed in an expanding cone and collided with the planet's surface. The Earth was just struck by a cosmic ray. Astronomers have devised numerous techniques for obtaining information from the cosmos in the past century. The stars emit visible light, infrared, ultraviolet, X-rays, and other invisible forms of light. The fact that cosmic rays are not light makes them so intriguing. These particles are directly arriving from deep space. Thousands or even millions of light years away, cosmic rays carry information about powerful forces and events. To comprehend what cosmic rays can tell us about the universe, however, we must understand how they are generated. In fact, it took scientists some time to realize that cosmic rays exist. The concept stems from the 1896 discovery of radioactivity by French physicist Henri Becquerel. Radioactivity is the particle radiation emitted by atoms spontaneously disintegrating in the environment. When scientists discovered radioactivity, they realized it could explain why an object's static electric charge could not be maintained indefinitely. Due to the radioactivity of rocks and soil, particles are always present close to the surface of the Earth. These particles can interact with anything that possesses an electric charge, resulting in the gradual loss of that charge. Scientists predicted more than a century ago that this effect would vanish if an electrically charged object were removed from the surface's natural radioactivity. The answer arrived in 1911 when an Austrian physicist, Victor Hess, began a series of daring balloon flights that would eventually carry him. Hess discovered more radiation at altitude than at sea level. By the time Hess landed, there was no longer any doubt that the Earth was bathed in cosmic radiation and a new scientific discipline was born. In time, scientists began to refer to the mysterious space radiation as cosmic rays. In the 1930s, the invention of the Geiger counter revealed that cosmic rays were bombarding Earth at an astounding rate, with tens of thousands of incoming particles per square meter per second. Most particles had relatively low energy, but a few could pass through rock or up to 1 meter of lead. Then, in 1938, the French physicist Pierre Augier traveled high into the Alps with Geiger counters to measure cosmic rays. He discovered that when two Geiger counters were placed far apart, they occasionally recorded the arrival of cosmic rays at precisely the same time of year. He had discovered cosmic rays, particle showers, and particle bursts that precipitated in an expanding spray after destroying a single, significantly more energetic particle in the upper atmosphere. Considering the magnitude of these showers, some cosmic rays from the depths of space were manifestly more energized than any particle created on Earth. Scientists have begun a new mission to determine the origin of these energetic particles. Then, thousands of light years away from Earth, a massive star dies in a spectacular explosion. This is a supernova, one of the most ferocious natural occurrences. As the powerful shockwave expands, it creates a halo of glowing gas called Cassiopeia, which the Hubble Space Telescope reveals in astonishing detail. But could this event also produce cosmic rays? The mystery of cosmic rays is being unraveled in stages. The ultimate objective is to determine how these high-energy particles are produced beyond our solar system. First, however, scientists had to determine what kind of particles they would get. Typically, these particles never reach the ground. Instead, they collide with the atmosphere, releasing a deluge of secondary particles that rain like subatomic shrapnel. In the 1930s and 1940s, scientists gradually honed in on the true nature of cosmic rays by studying these secondary particles. They discovered that approximately 90% of cosmic rays must be single protons. Protons are positively charged particles found in every atom in the universe, but most of them exist as hydrogen atoms, consisting of a single proton orbited by a single electron. The most abundant element in nature is hydrogen. Hydrogen is the primary component of stars and the vast gas clouds from which new stars form. Whoever or whatever generates cosmic rays and sends them our way has access to abundant raw materials. In 1947, a high-altitude balloon experiment demonstrated that most of the remaining 10% of cosmic rays are composed of the nuclei of heavy atoms such as iron, like protons. A powerful force strips these atomic nuclei of their electrons, hurtling them through space. What then? Even solar flares, which are enormous explosions on the sun's surface, cannot explain the energies behind these heavier cosmic rays. However, solar flares hint at the origin of cosmic rays, because solar flares are caused by magnetic energy release. A magnetic field can accelerate an electrically charged particle, such as a proton, to tremendous speeds under the right conditions. This principle is currently utilized in the Large Hadron Collider, the largest particle accelerator in the world. We're huge. When protons collide, a tremendous amount of energy is released, producing new particles that allow scientists to investigate the fundamental properties of matter. Some of the most powerful cosmic rays are astonishingly millions of times more powerful than the protons in the Large Hadron Collider. It implies that nature has created particle accelerators somewhere in space that dwarf anything humans have constructed on Earth. However, identifying them has proven extremely difficult. This is because interstellar space is a complex network of magnetic fields that encircle our galaxy. These fields have been deformed and twisted by turbulent interstellar gas motions. As a result, the magnetic fields completely jumble the directions of cosmic rays moving through the galaxy so that, from Earth's perspective, they appear to be coming from all over the sky with no indication of where they originated. In their attempts to explain cosmic rays, scientists hit a significant roadblock that required them to search the heavens in a new way. This is our Milky Way galaxy. Hundreds of billions of stars and vast dust and gas clouds stretch for thousands of light years in this region. It is an expansive and intricate system, and concealed within its depths are the origins of the high-energy particles known as cosmic rays. Enrico Fermi, a nuclear physicist, postulated in 1949 that cosmic rays are generated when protons and other charged particles are accelerated to high speeds by bouncing within a changing magnetic field. But where in the galaxy might conditions allow for such bouncing? Because cosmic ray particles are extremely energetic, their origins must be able to supply this energy. Moreover, these sources may reveal themselves by emitting X-rays, high-energy light. Earth's atmosphere absorbs X-rays from outer space, so X-ray telescopes must orbit high above the planet's surface. Today, the Chandra X-ray Observatory is the most sensitive X-ray telescope. Chandra has been used to peer into some of the galaxy's hottest and most active regions, revealing images such as this one of the Carina Nebula, where interstellar gas is heated to millions of degrees by newborn giant stars. This environment is high in energy but lacks the magnetic fields required to accelerate cosmic ray particles. So instead of focusing on regions where stars are born, cosmic ray hunters have zeroed in on regions where massive stars have perished violently. This spectacular ring is the remnant of a supernova, a massive stellar explosion that sprays matter in all directions, causing a shockwave to rapidly expand. This bubble's leading edge can travel at tens of thousands of kilometers per second, but this is nowhere near the speed of a cosmic ray particle. However, after Fermi, scientists realized that supernova shockwaves could compress and strengthen magnetic fields in the surrounding gas, and that charged particles moving back and forth across the shockwave could acquire more and more energy through a process known as Fermi acceleration. Eventually, the particles would move quickly enough to separate from the shockwave and escape into the galaxy. Finally, there was a theory capable of explaining cosmic rays. However, proof would require a different type of space observatory. Appropriately, this observatory is the Enrico Fermi named Fermi Space Telescope of NASA. Its detectors can detect gamma rays, a more energetic form of light than X-rays. Since its 2008 debut, the Fermi telescope has been used to investigate the universe's most extreme phenomena. Gamma ray telescopes search for unseen physics in the stars, such as the supermassive black holes at the centers of distant galaxies and the mysterious gamma ray bursts. In addition, Fermi has focused on two of the most intriguing supernova remnants in the Milky Way. One is 44, a dramatically expanding shell of gas located 10,000 light years away in the constellation Aquila the Eagle. Both of these colorful bubbles are the result of supernova explosions that expanded interstellar gas into dense clouds. Theoretically, this should be the ideal circumstance for Fermi acceleration to generate cosmic rays. The Fermi spacecraft is the ideal instrument for testing this hypothesis. Its sensitive detectors can differentiate between gamma rays generated by various physical processes. To be certain, scientists would require more than 4 years of Fermi data collection. However, In February 2013, they were finally prepared to reveal their findings. They discovered a distinct signal, the first indication that protons with high energies occasionally collide to produce gamma rays. Moreover, the signal type was identical to what was predicted if protons were accelerated to become cosmic rays. After a century since their discovery, the Fermi telescope has finally captured an image of cosmic ray formation. Scientists know more than ever before about cosmic rays. The search continues, however. The highest energy cosmic rays are so powerful that even a supernova shockwave cannot propel them. Consequently, searching for new sources of cosmic rays has expanded beyond the Milky Way. This is M87, a massive galaxy approximately 60 million light-years away. A vast black hole resides deep within its core. Its mass is equivalent to more than 6 billion suns. As it consumes surrounding gas, the black hole's rapid spin causes some gas to escape, forming a jet that extends hundreds of thousands of light-years into intergalactic space. The jet is surrounded by magnetic fields with sufficient strength to generate ultra-high-energy cosmic rays. Since they are so uncommon, extensive experiments covering thousands of square kilometers are required to capture only a handful of the most energetic particles in nature. Nonetheless, if the theory proves true for the first time, these experiments may be able to demonstrate that we are being bombarded by matter from another galaxy. Due to the discovery of cosmic rays, we know we are directly connected to some of the universe's most powerful phenomena. As a new chapter of exploration begins, we learn how extraordinary this connection to the universe may be. In the summer of 1950, scientists are taking a lunch break at the Los Alamos, New Mexico government laboratory. 5 years ago, this was the site of the Manhattan Project, the clandestine effort to develop the first atomic bomb. However, in a lighter moment, one table's conversation has turned to flying saucers. It begins with a humorous alien-related story. Soon, however, scientists will debate when interstellar travel may become feasible. Enrico Fermi, a Nobel Prize-winning physicist whose many contributions included the creation of the world's first nuclear reactor, is present. After a while, the conversation becomes more grounded. Then, completely unexpectedly for me, she blurts out a question. Where is everyone? Fermi was still considering extraterrestrials when he realized something was amiss. Fermi then performed some immediate calculations that confirmed his suspicions. We would have detected signs of advanced extraterrestrial civilizations by now if they existed elsewhere in the galaxy, possibly evidence of multiple civilizations. The fact that it has not occurred is the Fermi paradox. Fermi was not the first to wonder why we haven't discovered any signs of extraterrestrial life in the universe. However, as a talented scientist, he framed the issue in a way that would have repercussions far beyond the lunchtime discussion. Over 6 decades later, the Fermi paradox remains unresolved, despite mounting evidence that carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen are among the most common elements in the universe. Astronomers have also discovered hundreds of planets outside our solar system and directly observed the planet-forming disks that swirl around young stars. All of these new data indicate that if life once existed on this planet, it must have occurred multiple times, increasing our chances of encountering an advanced civilization. The lengthy history of life on Earth provides additional support for this optimistic argument. We know from fossils that numerous species have inhabited this planet over aeons, and we also know that evolution has successfully ensured that life continues to adapt and thrive in the face of changing environmental conditions. In addition, the earliest indications of life are not fossils but microscopic patterns and chemical traces in ancient rocks. These indicate that bacteria existed on Earth at least 3.5 billion years ago. Consequently, the first cells and DNA must have existed even earlier. Earth is approximately 4.6 billion years old. Along with the other planets, it formed that long ago from the leftover debris surrounding a newborn sun. After a few hundred million years for the Earth's surface to cool and the atmosphere to stabilize, life must have appeared here as quickly as possible. The essential ingredient was liquid water. Due to its early and sustained presence, water is an excellent solvent in which important biological molecules can interact and react. Thus, life was able to establish itself on Earth. It's possible that Earth is not alone. The NASA Curiosity rover landed in Gale Crater on Mars in August 2012. Curiosity found convincing evidence that the rock beneath its wheels had formed in stagnant water over several months as it traversed the crater's dusty floor. The presence of clay minerals in the rock indicates that the water was comparable to Earth's fresh water and conducive to life. This does not prove that Mars once supported life. However, this does indicate that Mars was once a habitable planet, at least for microorganisms. Some believe that underground Martian life may still exist on the planet today. Life originated in one or possibly both of the ocean environments of our solar system. Even if Mars is a lifeless planet, the score is 50%. And in a galaxy containing billions of planets, it isn't easy to believe that life has not yet been equally successful among the stars. Fermi realized, however, that there must be a catch. It may be a matter of searching for ET correctly. By peering into the depths of the universe, astronomers have encountered the vastness of time. Observations of distant galaxies indicate that the universe is expanding. Using expansion rate measurements, cosmologists now estimate that the Big Bang occurred approximately 13.8 billion years ago, half a billion years after the Big Bang. The formation of stars and galaxies was well underway, according to our most in-depth views of the universe. If so, our galaxy probably began to form around that time. Our solar system, in contrast, is less than 5 billion years old. It has existed for less than half of the Milky Way's age. This suggests ample time for other civilizations to emerge in the Milky Way before ours. When we find a person we can converse with, time should be on our side. Instead, we have the Fermi paradox, a puzzling question that asks whether or not life is abundant on Earth and whether or not the universe has existed for a long time. Why have we yet to spot any signs of life? In 1950, Fermi's question was prompted by a discussion among physicists about interstellar travel. The Fermi paradox holds true even if interstellar travel is impossible or impractical due to the vast distances involved. Because the technology to search the galaxy for extraterrestrial radio signals already exists. When Fermi posed his famous question, astronomers were already planning the construction of enormous radio dishes to explore the cosmos. Humanity had an ear to the cosmos for the first time in history. By 1960, the American astronomer Frank Drake was using a 26-meter dish in Greenbank, West Virginia, to listen for any possible radio emissions from extraterrestrial civilizations. It was the beginning of SETI, the search for intelligence from beyond Earth. Drake did not anticipate receiving a message intended for us, but he knew Earth was transmitting multiple signals through commercial broadcasts and military radar. Even if a future civilization is marginally more advanced than ours, it may emit significantly more energy at the outset. He presented an enormous needle in a haystack scenario. It was one thing to have the proper antenna for ET listening. It is another thing to know where to point it and which of the billions of possible frequencies to tune into. Drake's strategy consisted of pointing at a couple of nearby stars that resembled our sun and selecting frequencies between 14 and 20 megahertz, the frequency of radio waves emitted by hydrogen, the universe's most abundant atom. Before Frank Drake's search, enthusiasm for SETI was growing. Since no one had ever looked before, it was possible that the skies would be flooded with signals from advanced civilizations communicating in a galactic social network. Perhaps the solution to the Fermi paradox was as simple as turning on a radio receiver. But this was not the case. Drake's initial search was fruitless, as have been all subsequent attempts to detect extraterrestrial radio signals, at least thus far. Among the most extensive was Project Phoenix, which employed radio dishes in Australia and the United States to investigate approximately 800 carefully selected star systems. Scientists concluded that if an advanced civilization within 200 light-years of Earth had used radio transmission to announce its presence, we would have discovered it by now. Given that the Milky Way spans more than 100,000 light years, many galaxies remain to discover. However, Moore's law, which predicts a doubling of computer processing speed every 18 months, is accelerating the improvement of our ability to collect and analyze radio signals from outer space. Scientists at the SETI Institute in California are constructing the Allen Telescope Array to drastically increase the speed and volume of radio-based searches. If technology continues to advance at its current rate, humans will have listened in on more than 1 million star systems by the middle of this century. If no alien civilization has been discovered by then, Fermi's paradox will become more pressing than ever. And we will be left to ponder why the chemical and biological processes that led to our emergence have yet to be repeated elsewhere, or at least not frequently enough for us to find someone to converse with. Our presence on Earth is evidence that life exists elsewhere in the universe. However, it does not reveal the likelihood of life over the next 4 years. In 2009, the Kepler spacecraft discovered evidence of thousands of planets in a small section of the sky on which it focused its attention. Although many of these findings must be confirmed by additional observations, the numbers suggest that tens of billions of planets in the Milky Way share Earth's size. But we also know that there cannot be billions of civilizations attempting to communicate with us, or we would have heard from some of them by now. Where did they go? Is this how Enrico Fermi originally posed the question? Given the potential for so many civilizations to exist in our galaxy, is it realistic to assume we are alone? Since Fermi posed his famous paradox decades ago, numerous attempts have been made to resolve it. One set of explanations considers the possibility that extraterrestrials exist, but are unable or unwilling to communicate with humans. For instance, intelligent life may exist on other planets without advanced technology or in environments where radio communication is impractical, such as underwater. We may also need to overestimate the interest of alien civilizations in contacting us. As societies advance, they may also become more inwardly focused. Some have speculated that aliens are aware of our existence but quietly observe us as if scientists were observing another species in its natural habitat. The difficulty with these speculations is that for every society that does not wish to say hello, we can imagine others that do. Curiosity and communication have provided substantial benefits to our survival. The more information we collect about our environment, the better we can prepare for unanticipated threats or take advantage of incoming resources. It is reasonable to assume that some extraterrestrial civilizations are interested in communication. We assume that such a civilization would send out interstellar probes. Voyager 1 was the first human-made probe to leave the solar system and enter interstellar space in 2013. With a few centuries of technological advancement, we could send probes to the stars that are significantly faster and more sophisticated. These probes could be equipped with instructions for locating a moon or asteroid with sufficient resources to make copies of themselves, which would then be dispatched to explore further. John von Neumann, a mathematician and computer science pioneer, proposed the concept of a self-replicating machine. If such spacecraft could travel at 1/40 the speed of light, they would be approximately 400 times faster than Voyager. After a few million years, they would have visited every star system in the Milky Way. However, that is merely the blink of an eye. The absence of any evidence of von Neumann machines in our solar system suggests that they have never been constructed in the history of our planet. Consequently, there are likely few advanced civilizations in the universe, otherwise someone would have already done it. This type of reasoning has centered on the history of life, our world, and the remarkable chain of coincidences that has given our species virtual control over the entire planet. However, we may be more exceptional than we believe. Despite the rapid emergence of life on the Earth's complex surface, multicellular life took billions of years to evolve. If a planet cannot maintain a stable environment for that length of time, then it can only support a bacterial world. In 2000, astronomer Don Brownlee and paleontologist Peter Ward examined how many factors must exist for a planet like Earth. Even though simple life may be prevalent throughout the universe, they concluded that complex life is an exception. They termed their theory the rare Earth hypothesis, and within the next decade or so, we may better understand whether they are correct. Scientists at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology are developing the Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite, or TESS. Its mission is to detect Earth-like planets transiting in front of nearby stars. Even follow-up observations of microbial life may detect traces of life on these planets by analyzing the starlight passing through the atmosphere. If TESS discovers planets that may be hospitable to bacteria but nothing else, we may inhabit a rare Earth universe. Another method for resolving the Fermi paradox is to consider the possibility that the technology required to contact another civilization may also be the technology that enables a civilization to self-destruct. So far, we have managed to avoid self-destruction. However, our future is still being determined, given the increasing pressure on our planet. One of the greatest ironies of the Fermi paradox is that it was first brought up in a conversation between brilliant scientists working in a military laboratory during the Cold War. This should remind us that the paradox is a peculiar quirk of the universe and a vital warning for our civilization. Fermi's paradox tells us, if nothing else, that long-lasting civilizations may be exceedingly rare and will require great perseverance to become one of them. If we are ever successful in receiving a message from another intelligent species, we will have two reasons to celebrate. First, it will indicate that we are not alone, and thanks to our vigilance, neither are they. In February 2013, a solitary rocket stood poised beneath a cloudless sky at Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. You may possess 10 as the countdown commences. Tension permeates the air. It is a perfect day for space travel. But with so much riding on this single launch, mission controllers have good reason to be anxious. The Atlas V rocket carries an advanced space explorer with cameras that can observe multiple wavelengths and reveal hidden details that the human eye cannot perceive. If this mission fails, decades of scientific progress will be jeopardized. If the mission is successful, however, our understanding of the most intriguing planet in the solar system will be greatly enhanced. The Earth is the planet. And the mission is just the most recent in a long line of spacecraft that have altered our perspective of Earth. And this is precisely why the stakes are so high right now. The mission of Landsat 8 involves more than simply launching another satellite. It involves maintaining a data dynasty. The Landsat program has operated for over 40 years, providing a continuous record of our planet's transformation. 8 scientists hope to extend this record into the distant future using Landsat. They may witness a more profound change than anticipated when the Landsat program was initiated. It was a beginning motivated by an entirely different objective. At Earth. However, in 1962, after the Mercury program, this began to change. By then, US astronauts had access to high-quality handheld cameras and the time to utilize them. The duration of the final Mercury mission exceeded 34 hours. In an era when scientists still relied on black and white aerial photographs to examine Earth's terrain, the photographs were particularly impressive. As the Mercury program morphed into the Gemini program, the orbital flights became longer, sometimes lasting several days, and the quality of the photographs improved. Gemini astronauts had taken approximately 1,100 photographs of mountains, lakes, deserts, and coastlines by 1966. Consequently, their images frequently revealed inaccessible and understudied regions of the Earth. Before then, these images were breathtaking and valuable to scientists. Images captured from orbit were primarily used to observe weather patterns. Now, scientists are beginning to comprehend the advantages of having a satellite dedicated to exploring the surface of the Earth from space. William Pecora, the United States Geological Survey Director, was a prominent proponent of the concept. Pecora recognized that the space program could significantly enhance our understanding of Earth's agricultural and natural resources. And this was precisely the time when global population growth and industrialization made such information crucial. Therefore, in September 1966, Pecora urged the US the Interior Department will introduce a new space-based observation program. Earth Resources Technology Satellite was the primary component. However, only a few were enthusiastic about the concept. As NASA was already heavily invested in a human crewed mission to the moon, government administrators resisted spending additional funds on a completely different space project. Others were concerned about the legal and political implications of launching a satellite capable of observing the territories of other nations from space. In addition, the United States military has operated its own spy satellite since 1959. Defense officials could have been more eager for the public to comprehend the extraordinary power of space surveillance. Despite these obstacles, the concept of a satellite for civilian Earth observation gradually gained support. In 1970, NASA received approval to construct such a spacecraft. Its design was based on the weather satellites that have been in operation since 1964. However, this spacecraft was equipped with cameras that could image features on the Earth's surface as small as 80 meters in visible and near-infrared light. In addition, it included a tape recorder for replaying data collected from virtually any location on Earth. On July 23, 1972, the Earth Resources Technology satellite, ERTS, was successfully launched into orbit after rapid assembly. William Pecora, a geologist and federal administrator who had vigorously advocated for the mission, had passed away in the hospital just days before. He was 59. Pecora never had the opportunity to witness the satellite's scientific returns, later renamed Landsat 1. However, the returns were impressive, and Landsat 1 would provide a treasure trove of data about our planet over the next 5.5 years. It had company. Landsat 2 was launched in 1975, expanding the program's reach and longevity. In the next 5 years, this pattern of overlapping missions would continue into the 1980s and beyond. And about time as well. Landsat may have been conceived due to the space race, but it would mature when scientists were racing to comprehend Earth's profound environmental changes. Landsat would provide them with a front-row seat. Off the coast of Labrador, an uncharted speck of land less than 50 meters in diameter protrudes from the icy waters. In 1976, after centuries of maritime exploration, Landsat 1 finally detected it. It is still known as Landsat Island. Since its inception in 1972, the Landsat program has added numerous such details to our global map. However, the Landsat program's absolute value is not adding new locations to the map, but seeing what is already there in a completely new light. Each Landsat satellite can observe the Earth's surface in various light wavelengths, some of which are beyond the range of human vision. By assigning contrasting hues to these wavelengths, researchers can reveal details too subtle to discern in a traditional color photograph. For instance, a small but lush corner of Oman stands in stark contrast to the surrounding desert. This region is distinct from the rest of the Arabian Peninsula because summer monsoon rains are captured by the mountains and used to irrigate a rich and fertile strip of coastal lowland. This vibrantly colored section of Axelheiberg Island in Canada's high Arctic depicts the expanse of icy glaciers among the island's rugged mountains, which are depicted in yellow. Landsat can also reveal ephemeral characteristics. Off the Mississippi Delta, 600 kilometers west of Chile, newly transported river sediments form spectral ribbons in the Pacific Ocean. The clouds over a remote island display a repeating pattern of eddies caused by the wind. Without a doubt, Landsat has provided us with a dramatically different perspective on the natural geographic diversity of Earth. But even more illuminating is how the program has documented the expanding human impact on the planet. Occasionally, change operates on such a massive scale that we can only fully comprehend its effects by observing it from space. This is truer nowhere than at the RLC. The RLC, once the fourth largest lake in the world and a vast inland sea the size of Ireland, has disappeared in just a few decades, due to the primary diversion of its tributaries for irrigation. This sequence of Landsat images illustrates the perils of diminishing water levels. They eliminate a once thriving fishery and replace it with a desolate, salty wasteland. Landsat has also been instrumental in documenting various types of loss in the Amazon basin. For example, the program's satellites have observed vast areas of rainforest being cleared for logging and agriculture. This sequence illustrates the progression of this process in Rondônia, northwest Brazil. First, the rainforest is divided into a fishbone pattern, and then logging roads are extended into the virgin territory. The paralyzed sections of the forest are then removed systematically. Since Landsat began photographing the region, roughly 16% of the Amazon rainforest has vanished. Landsat imagery has captured the expanding scale of development elsewhere on the planet. Las Vegas, for instance, is rapidly expanding across the Nevada desert, putting a significant strain on water resources in one of the driest regions of the United States. Meanwhile, on the other side of the globe, a new lake formed behind China's massive Three Gorges Dam. This massive hydroelectric project, completed in 2012, displaced over 1 million people worldwide. The pursuit of energy and its consequences is a recurring theme that has produced some of the most arresting images captured by Landsat. In the wilderness of northern Alberta, Landsat observes the opening of vast tracts of land for oil extraction along the Athabasca River. Along the Persian Gulf, the wealthy Emirate of Dubai, a product of the oil boom in the Middle East, displays its geographic creativity by erecting artificial islands in the form of palm trees and a world map. On the actual world map, however, it is evident that the continued use of oil and other fossil fuels significantly impacts the planet. Here, Landsat captures the stunning retreat of Alaska's Columbia Glacier. As global warming advances, rapid ice melting and sea level rise are inevitable. Yet, just as our awareness of the magnitude of this change was growing, Lance provided invaluable insight into how our planet was at risk of vanishing forever. As humanity confronts global warming, the ability to continuously monitor Earth's surface from space has become a prerequisite for any future efforts to manage the planet's resources and protect its irreplaceable biodiversity. The Landsat program was designed specifically for this purpose. Because Landsat images have a relatively broad field of view, they do not depict finer details such as individual trees or buildings. Instead, Landsat provides a broad perspective designed to capture regional scale changes. Each satellite in the series was designed to orbit the Earth in a polar orbit, enabling it to photograph the planet in a series of north to south strips. Beginning with Landsat 3, each satellite was placed in an orbit approximately 700 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The orbit is also synchronized with the Sun so that when the satellite passes overhead during the day, it is approximately 10 a.m. local time below. Due to the orbit's timing and positioning, a satellite can image any specific location on Earth every 16 days at the same time of day. This is especially useful for tracking long-term trends because the lighting angle is roughly the same each time an image is captured of a particular location. Due to this visual continuity, the Landsat database became more valuable over time, so researchers were particularly concerned when Landsat 6's launch in October 1993 was unsuccessful. The Landsat program had already narrowly avoided being terminated due to budget constraints, and Landsat 5, despite still functioning properly, had been in space for 9 years. Before the United States could fund, construct, and launch Landsat 7 in 1999, it had to wait 6 years. This launch was successful, but a few years later, a crucial piece of hardware failed, rendering the spacecraft partially blinded and its images incomplete. Obtaining approval for the next Landsat would be a long and difficult battle. Landsat 8 was the most advanced satellite in the series and a rescue mission for the entire program when it was launched in 2013. Then, just 6 weeks before the big launch, Landsat 5 failed. In January 2013, after a record-setting 28 years of observation, it ceased communicating with mission controllers. Only Landsat 7 remained, no longer operating at maximum capacity. With Landsat 8 poised for launch in February, the fate of the entire program hung in the balance. Finally, they ascended into the air on a column of white smoke. The rocket launched its valuable payload into orbit. The good news was confirmed shortly after that. Landsat 8 had been successfully launched, and its systems were operating normally. Scientists were overjoyed and relieved. In the coming weeks, the new mission would demonstrate its prowess by transmitting even more spectacular images than its predecessors had. In May, the satellite had reached full functionality and transmitted more than 400 images daily. It is evident from these initial Landsat 8 images that the entire program has entered a new phase and that its continuous coverage will likely prove invaluable as we have entered an era of unprecedented global change. Obviously, Landsat is not the only artificial intelligence, AI, in the sky observing the Earth. Multiple Earth-observing satellites, such as Terra, a multinational spacecraft operated by NASA with specialized sensors for monitoring environmental change, orbit the planet every minute. Or, similar to the RadarSat program in Canada, a constellation of satellites that can see the Earth day and night. Its radar vision can see through clouds and fog to create stunning high-resolution surface images. Considering how things have progressed since the early days of Landsat, it is evident that we are now in an era of specialized planetary monitoring that no single satellite could handle on its own. However, Landsat's ever-expanding record of our planet continues to serve as the basis for an entire Earth observation system. In the end, that is where the land begins. Initiating the program decades ago has had the greatest impact. Researchers were not only developing a camera for photographing Earth from space, they were establishing a new scientific discipline, remote sensing. As the rate of global environmental change quickens, it becomes increasingly apparent that this is a field of study we cannot do without.